Good evening. Today we are going to start the third chapter in your first textbook, which is Motion in a Straight Line. This is not a very difficult chapter because most of it you have learned in class 9. And so we are just building up on what you know from class 9. Okay. Now if you would have got the notes that I sent you on WhatsApp. If you look through the notes, you will see that the first topic given in that chapter is distance and displacement. I'm sure all of you know by now the basic differences between distance and displacement. But anyway, let's just discuss it again. See, suppose we have, let's say, a point A and another point B. Let's say this is your home and this is where your school is situated. We have one student traveling through this path and reaching the school. That is student 1. We have another student traveling straight from home to school. We have a third student going another path. That's the third student taking another path from A to B. Now, the length of the actual path covered by these students is what you call as the distance. The length of the actual path, you will see that 1, 2 and 3, all three of them have covered different paths. The first person has gone through this path, the second here, and the third one has gone through this path. If you measure the actual length of the path, the path of the actual length that was covered by each of these students, then the length of the actual path covered is what you call as path length, which is also called as distance. But when you come to the displacement quantity, we mean the shortest distance measured from the initial position to the final position. That is the shortest distance measured from the initial position to the final position, then that is what you call as displacement. In the case of the second student, the distance, the actual path covered by him, the distance, that is the length of the actual path covered by him and the shortest distance between the initial and the final position are the same. But in this case and in this case, the distance covered is greater than the displacement. So this is by definition how distance and displacement are different. Now suppose, let's imagine a person travels from, let's call this as the origin. Here we have origin, point A. He travels up to point B, which is at 40 meters from the origin. And then having reached here, so he walks up to here and then he walks back to point C, which is, let's say, at 30 meters from the origin. Now what happens here is, if you're going to calculate the distance that he traveled to reach his final position, so his initial position is O, final position is C, the actual distance that he covered or the actual path length is, he walked from here to here first, which is 40, plus he walked another, this 40 to 30 would be another 10 meters. He walked another 10 meters. So the total distance that he covered is 50 meters. On the other hand, if you're talking about displacement, it is the shortest distance from the initial and the final position. That is, from A to C, if you measure the shortest distance, that is only 30 meters. So you see, displacement is 30 meters in this case, whereas distance is 50 meters in this case. Now, how did you get this 40? You considered only the magnitude, not the direction. First, initially he traveled to the right and then he travels to the left, but you ignored the direction. You simply added the magnitudes and you got the 50 meter. And since we consider only the magnitude, we say that distance is a scalar quantity, because we are not interested in the direction. We only add the magnitudes. In this case, how did we get the 30 meters? When he traveled to the right, we take it as plus 40. And then when he travels to the left, we change the direction and we took it as minus. He traveled another 10 to the left, minus 10. And that is how we got the 30 meter. So here, not only are we considering the direction, the magnitude, we also consider the directions of motion, and because of that we get the 30 meter. So because the magnitude and the directions are important in this case, we take displacement to be a vector quantity. Now by convention, if you have the coordinate axis, this is the x axis and this is the y axis, this is the origin. All measurements taken to the right of the origin and above the origin are taken to be positive. All measurements taken to the left and below the origin are taken to be negative. And that is why when he traveled to the left, we took it as negative. So now we see that distance is a scalar quantity, whereas displacement is a vector quantity. Another difference between a scalar and a vector quantity is, suppose he travels in a closed path. Closed path means, instead of stopping at C, he walks back to his original position O. So that means, he started from A, went up till B, and then from B he walked back to O and reached and final position is O. The distance he travelled is, he went 40 meters here and then he travelled back 40 meters. Because we are interested only in the magnitude, we write here 40. The total distance he travelled is 80 meters. Whereas, if you look at the displacement, to the right he went plus 40, then he walked back another minus 40. So 40 minus 40, you will get his displacement in this case as 0. So displacement, a vector quantity, in a closed path will be 0, but distance can never be 0. So distance can never be 0, but displacement can be 0. Another difference that we may discuss in this case between distance and displacement is, see, in the first diagram that I showed you, where we have from A to B, we have the second student traveling the shortest path, the first student here and this student here. You will see if you measure this distance and this distance and this distance, they can have any value. They need not be all the same. They will all have different values. But displacement can have only one unique value, which is the shortest distance between the two positions, that is the initial and the final. So distance, this can be different from this, can be different from this, can have any value, but displacement can have only one unique value, which is the shortest distance between the initial and the final position. So these are some of the differences between distance, which is called as path length, and displacement. After this discussion in your notes, you will see that we go on to discuss what you mean by average speed and average velocity. Now, average speed defined as distance by time, which you've learned in the 9th standard, and the average velocity is defined as this is total distance by total time. Total distance by total time. Here this will be total displacement by total time. So naturally, total time. Both of them will have the SI unit of meter per second. Distance in meters and time in second. Displacement also in meters, time in second. So SI unit is meter per second. And because displacement is a vector quantity, velocity also becomes a vector quantity. Here distance is a scalar quantity, so speed is also a scalar quantity. In our initial example where we said that this person starts from A, which is at the origin, walks up to B, which is 40 meters, and then walks back to C, which is at, let's say, 30 meters. Let's imagine that he took 4 minutes to cover this 40 meters. And then to walk back from B to C, let's imagine he took another 1 minute. So if you want to calculate the average speed, then distance covered was from here till here 40 plus another 10, 50. So distance would be 50 divided by total time he took was up till here he took 4 minutes and then he took a 1 minute to walk back to 30. So to reach from A to C, he took 5 minutes, and that will give you 10 meter per second, right? Whereas if you're looking at displacement, his displacement from A to C is only 30 meters. So displacement 30 divided by to reach from A to C, he still took 5 minutes. He walked up till B and came back to C. His displacement is only so much, but to reach C, he took a total time of 4 minutes plus the 1 minute, that is 5, and so his average velocity is only 6 meters per second. So with this discussion, you would have now realized displacement and distance can be equal, which means average speed and average velocity can be equal, but displacement is always, displacement can never be greater than distance. Distance will always be greater than or equal to displacement. Similarly, average speed can be greater than or equal to average velocity. Average speed will not be less than average velocity. Okay. So that is average speed and average velocity. Now we go on to discuss instantaneous speed and instantaneous velocity. Before that, let us discuss what is uniform motion and non-uniform motion. Uniform motion, again, this you would have learned in 9th standard, is when a body covers equal distances in equal intervals of time. So uniform motion, suppose, see, we know that average velocity defined as v bar, written as v bar, is the total distance covered in the time interval. Total time I'll represent as delta t. So let's imagine a body started from x1 position and reached a position x2, started at a time t1 and reached x2 at time t2. Then this is what you call as delta x, and this interval is what you call as delta t. So this is final position minus initial position divided by t2 minus t1, which is a time interval. Now this average velocity, if the body is covering equal distances in equal intervals of time, then you say that the body is in uniform motion. For example, suppose, let's say we have a body. I'm going to plot the xt graph. Okay, I'm going to plot t in seconds here, and I'm going to plot x in meters here. So in the first 1 second, the body covers 1 meter from the origin. Okay, so here we have, here. In the next 1 second, it's covering another 1 meter. So it's gone 2 meters from the origin. So we now have the point here. In the next 1 second, that is 2 to 3, 1 second, it covers 1 more meter. So let's say it's 3 meters from the origin. So you will see it's here. So if you plot this line, you will see it is a straight line because the body is covering equal distances in equal intervals of time. Such a motion is what you call as uniform motion. So now if you calculate the average velocity, the velocity is remaining a constant because it is covering equal distances in equal intervals of time always. So it means that in uniform motion, the velocity will be a constant and the graph will be a straight line. The xt graph will be a straight line for a body in uniform motion. Suppose a body is in non-uniform motion, then the body will cover unequal distances in equal intervals of time. So that means, let's say, for example, a train. A train, let's say, is traveling at, it's traveling at a distance, it's traveling 10 meters in 1 second. Okay, it's traveling fast, 10 meters in 1 second. And then the driver decides to apply the brakes, so the train will slow down. So let's say in the next 1 second, it has slowed down and therefore covers only 5 meters. And then it further slows down before coming to a stop. Let's say in 1 second, it's covering only 2 meters. Now you see, the time interval we have taken is the same, 1 second. Delta t remains to be the same, but the distance covered, delta x in each time interval, is going on changing, which means that it is covering unequal distances in equal intervals of time. Such a motion is what you call as a non-uniform motion. So if it's a non-uniform motion, then when you draw the xt graph, you will see that the time interval and the x in meters, you will see that it's not going to be a straight line because it is covering unequal distances in equal intervals of time. So this is how you distinguish between uniform motion and non-uniform motion. Now your next topic, which is the instantaneous velocity or instantaneous speed. If you're considering the direction, then we talk about instantaneous velocity. If you're only bothered about the magnitude, then we talk about the instantaneous speed. Now when suppose you are traveling from, let's say, Kochi to Trivandrum, and you calculated the average velocity. Average velocity is you calculate the total distance between Kochi and Trivandrum, the shortest distance, and then you divide it by the total time you took, and you got, let's say, 80 km/h. You traveled at 80 km/h. This is your average speed, which you got by dividing the total displacement by total time. Okay. This does not mean that at every instant your car was maintaining 80 km/h. Definitely not. If you are on the highway and there are no other cars on the road or no other vehicle on the road, then probably you may be traveling at, let's say, 100 km/h. If there's a traffic jam and you can't move fast, let's say you're traveling only at 40 km/h. So average speed does not mean that you have maintained that constant speed over the entire distance. You have just divided the total displacement by the total time to get the average velocity. Instantaneous, so as you travel, your speedometer will show you the instantaneous velocity. That is, at each instant, if you're in a traffic jam, you can look at your speedometer. If the needle shows 40 km/h, it means that at that instant, your car is traveling at 40 km/h. If you're on the highway without any other vehicle, then if your speedometer shows 100 km/h, it means that your car is traveling at that instant at 100 km/h. So the speedometer gives you the instantaneous velocity, and you define the instantaneous velocity as the velocity of a body at that instant, which is defined as, see here, we defined average velocity as what? Average velocity we defined as delta x by delta t, which is the time that you took from going from x1 to x2, to travel from x1 to x2. Your initial time starting was t1, the final time was t2, and this interval of time is what you call as delta t. This interval is what you call as delta x. Now for instantaneous velocity, this interval of time must become extremely small. That is, it should be close to an instant where delta t tends to 0, meaning it cannot be exactly 0. Time 0, it can't be. But the time interval should become so small that it is tending to 0, almost close to 0. So then that small interval of time is what you represent as dt. And the small displacement that happens in that extremely small interval of time, we represent as dx. So we define instantaneous velocity. Average velocity is written with a bar on top. Instantaneous velocity, simply v, is equal to limit as delta t tends to 0. That means your time interval is tending to 0. Extremely small interval of time, which is called an instant. Delta x by delta t is then defined as or written as dx by dt. So instantaneous velocity is defined as the limit as delta t, the limit of average velocity, the limit of average velocity as delta t tends to 0, written as dx by dt. So this is the definition for instantaneous velocity. Its SI unit is again meter per second. You have two ways of finding out the instantaneous velocity. One, you can find it out graphically. The other, you can find it out by using differential calculus, which I will be teaching you today. If you are using the graphical method, let us first look at the uniform motion graph, which I just showed you. We know if this is t and this is the x axis, this is the, you're taking the position, this is called the position time graph, or you may call it as a distance time graph or displacement time graph. What you're plotting here is x, the position of the body, which gives you the distance of the body, allengil displacement of the body in time interval t. So if this is a straight line, I just told you that it represents uniform motion which has constant velocity, no change in velocity. It is covering equal distances in equal intervals of time. Now in sense standard, you might have learned that the slope of a line is given by tan theta, where theta is the angle made by the line with the positive x-axis. This is your x-axis and this is your y-axis. So theta here is the angle made by the graph with the positive x-axis, and slope of this line is given by tan theta. In 10th standard, I'm sure you've learned tan theta is, if you take a right angle triangle here, tan of theta will be the opposite side by the adjacent side. Now on this axis, let us say the position, initial position of the body was here, x1, at time t1, and at time t2 the body reached a position x2. Okay, so here if you find the slope of the line, which I told you is tan theta, and in 10th standard you know tan theta is opposite side by adjacent side. Here opposite side is this. This distance will be, here it is x2 and here it is x1. So this distance will be x2 minus x1, and the adjacent side is this distance, which will be t2 minus t1. So this is t2 minus t1, which is, as you know, delta x by delta t, which is what you define as average velocity. So from the graph you can find out the average velocity by simply finding out what? Tan of theta, the slope of the line. Slope of this line of the xt graph will give you the velocity of the body. Now here we know that the velocity is a constant velocity. That means at, let's say we take different time, every instant if you draw, if you find theta, you will see that the theta is the same. So slope of the line is the same, tan theta at every point is the same, which means slope of the line is the same throughout. Slope of the line gives you the velocity of the body, so velocity is remaining a constant. Okay, now another thing I want you to understand from this is, in 10th standard again you have learned the equation for a straight line, given by the equation y equal to mx plus c. So let us look at that now. You also learned the three equations of motions in 9th standard, which is v equal to u plus at, s is equal to ut plus half at square, and v square minus u square equal to 2as. I'm taking the second equation, s is equal to ut plus half at square. Okay, now this s, as you know, is the distance covered or displacement, which is what we have represented with the letter x. So I'm going to write here as, instead of s, I'm using x, because in your textbook, 11th standard textbook, they are denoting it with x, not s. Okay, now here we are talking about constant velocity, right? So throughout the velocity is the same, that means the body is not accelerating. So here uniform motion, there is no acceleration, a equal to 0. So now if you write this equation, this will be x is equal to ut plus 0. Okay, now check here, this x is the variable along the y-axis. This is a y-axis. So x is the variable along the y-axis equal to u, which is the initial velocity, is a constant throughout. That constant I will write as m. T is the variable along the x-axis, so I may write it as x plus c. This equation you are familiar with in 10th standard math. It represents a straight line whose slope is this m. M represents the slope and c represents the y-intercept. So if you compare these two equations, you will see that x is the variable along the y-axis. Here, t is the variable along the x-axis. The m, that is the slope of the line, represents the velocity, which is what I just told you. Slope of the line tan theta of the xt graph gives you the velocity. From this equation also you will see the slope, which is represented by m, will give you the velocity of the body. Initial velocity u, but throughout it is remaining a constant initial velocity. Now here y-intercept c, if you compare with this equation, is 0, which means that your line is starting from the origin. Y-intercept is the distance covered along the y-axis when t equal to 0. So y-intercept is here 0, so it is starting from the origin. Okay, so in both ways you will now notice that whether you are using tan theta, you will get the slope of the line, which gives you the velocity of the body. Similarly, from this equation also you will see that the slope of the line gives you velocity. Slope of the st graph, xt graph, gives you the velocity of the body. Now this is the, then I told you in this case at every instant the velocity is the same because it is uniform motion. Now suppose you were to deal with non-uniform motion where it is not a straight line, then what happens is you can find out the instantaneous velocity. Let's take this graph where we have t here in seconds, we have x here in meters, and we have got a non-uniform motion. Okay, now let's say the initially the particle, the body is at x1, after, so this is at time t1, after some time, let's say at t2, the particle, the body has reached a new position, x2. So you may find the average velocity x2 minus x1 by t2 minus t1, which is delta x by delta t. From the graph you can find out the average velocity graphically, even if it is non-uniform motion or uniform, or uniform motion, x2 minus x1 by t2 minus t1. But suppose you want to find out the instantaneous velocity, then this time interval, see, suppose you want to find the velocity at, let's say, 4 seconds, okay? You want to find out the velocity at 4 seconds of this body. Then, at that point, the time interval here has reduced to an instant here. So, at that instant, 4 seconds, you need to find out the velocity. What you do is, you simply draw the tangent to that point. You simply draw the tangent to that point, and the tangent at that point, and then the slope of the tangent will give you the velocity at that instant. I don't know if this is clear to you. So this is your, so you need to find out, let's say here. So you just simply draw the tangent here, and the slope of the tangent will give you the velocity, instantaneous velocity at that instant, let's say 4 seconds. Now you will see at this point, if you draw the tangent, this will be theta. So at each time, at each position here, the instantaneous velocity will be given by the tangent here. So you see that theta is going on changing. So tan theta going on changing would mean that velocity is going on changing because it is non-uniform motion. So if it is uniform motion, you know tan theta will be the same at every instant. So at any point you may find the tan theta and you will get the instantaneous velocity. For a non-uniform motion, whichever point, at whichever instant you want to find the instantaneous velocity, draw the tangent, and tan theta, slope of that tangent, will give you the instantaneous velocity. So graphically, this is how you will find the instantaneous velocity. Then I also told you, numerically, you can find the instantaneous velocity, but for that you need to know differential calculus, because we define instantaneous velocity as dx by dt, which is derivative. So this is equivalent to writing d by dt of x, that is the derivative of x with respect to t. So this is how you will read it. Derivative of x with respect to t. That is instantaneous velocity. For this, you need to know few rules of differential calculus. Differential calculus, I think those who have taken math in 11th standard, you will be learning towards the end of this year and more of it next year in class 12. So even if you have taken math or not, it doesn't matter in physics, because right now all of you are at the same level. You do not, none of you know this differential calculus. We need only two or three formulas for us to solve these problems numerically, and those formulas I will teach you now. So you don't have to worry if you've not taken math in 11th standard. Physics, a few formulas is more than enough for you to do these problems. Okay, the first rule is for differentiating. The first rule I'm going to give you is, suppose y is equal to a constant, then dy by dx, that is derivative of y with respect to x, will be equal to 0. For example, if y is equal to a constant, let's say 5, then d by dx of 5, that is derivative of 5 with respect to x, will be equal to 0. Or let's say y is equal to pi. Pi is a number, 3.14. Then d by dx of pi, which is just a number, will be 0. That is, derivative of constants is equal to 0. Then the next rule, the second one. Let's say y is equal to x raised to n. Okay. Then dy by dx will be d by dx of y is x raised to n. So you are differentiating with respect to x. You are going to differentiate x raised to n. This is n into x raised to n minus 1. This is a rule. So for example, if y is equal to x raised to 3, then dy by dx is going to be d by dx of y is x cubed. So with your rule, power n. So n into, so 3 into x raised to n minus 1. 3 minus 1 will be 2, and you get it as 3x squared. Okay, let me show you one more example. Let's say we have y equal to root x. Root x can be written as x raised to half. So then dy by dx is d by dx of x raised to half, which is power n, n into x raised to n minus 1. So half into x raised to half minus 1, which is half into x raised to minus half, which is, I'll write it here, which is equal to 1 by 2 into, this minus will bring it to the denominator, so 1 by x raised to half will be root x, so 1 by root x. Okay, I'll give you one more example. Let's say you have y equal to 1 by root x. Find out dy by dx, that is d by dx of x raised to minus half, because your root x is in the denominator. So this, when it comes out, it will become minus half. Applying this rule, we have n is minus 1 by 2 x raised to n minus 1. So minus 1 by 2 minus 1, which is equal to minus 1 by 2 x raised to minus 1 by 2 minus 1 would be minus 3 by 2, which is equivalent to writing minus 3 into 1 by 2. So we have minus 1 by 2 here. This will come into the denominator. So this will be 1 by, this x raised to half will be root. So we have cube root of x. 1 by 2 minus 1 by 2, 1 by cube root of x. Okay. So this is the simple formula that you will follow if you have x raised to n dy by dx. The next rule is, suppose we had, let's say, y equal to x, and you are asked to find out dy by dx, which is equal to writing d by dx of x raised to 1, right? So if you apply the formula n into x raised to n minus 1, this would be 1 into x raised to 1 minus 1, n minus 1. This will be 1 into x raised to 0. Anything raised to 0, you know, is 1. So dy by dx, if y equal to x, will be 1 itself. Then the last thing that you need to know in this is, suppose we have, let's say, y equal to 5x raised to 4. Okay. And you are asked to find out dy by dx, that is differentiating y with respect to x. So this will be d by dx of 5 into x raised to 4. Now I told you in the first rule that differential of a constant is 0. But that is if the constant is appearing alone. But here it is 5 into x raised to 4. Then what happens is, you keep the 5 a constant there and differentiate only x raised to 4 using the formula n into x raised to n minus 1. So that will be 4, which is n, into x raised to n minus 1, which is 5 into 4 is 20, x 4 minus 1 is cube, 20 x cube. Okay, one more example I'll show you. Suppose, let's say, y is equal to 3x squared plus 2x minus 2. Okay, we'll differentiate each one separately. So find dy by dx, that is d by dx of y happens to be 3x squared plus 2x minus 2. I'm going to differentiate this first. This is a constant along with x squared. So I will first take out 3 into x squared. N into x raised to n minus 1 will give you 2 into x raised to 2 minus 1 plus, this is also appearing along with x, so take that 2 outside as a constant. This is x raised to 1, so into 1 into x raised to 1 minus 1. Then this is just a constant, so that will be 0. So now we have 3 into 2 is 6, x, 2 minus 1 is 1, plus this is 0, so that will remain as 1. So 6x plus 2, and that will be dy by dx. Okay, so we'll stop the class now. Just go through this video before your next class, because we'll be doing sums on this, finding out. So just now I told you, you can find out the instantaneous velocity of a body in two ways. One, the graphical method, simply finding the slope of the tangent at the point where you want to find out the instantaneous velocity. That's a graphical method. Or by differential calculus, I've given you the rules. So you can find out the instantaneous velocity simply by doing dx by dt, and which will come through practice. Okay. So bye and good night.